All right, Casey, Oxendine here at the beautiful Victoria Hotel down in downtown Melbourne, Australia. We are getting ready for AFC 4. We like to talk a game, you know? I'm here with the big cat, Tom Erikson. This is an MMA legend there at the golden era of this sport. You're here with Sean McCorkle getting ready for that big main event against Soa Pelele. Talk with us a little bit about Sean's training leading up to this fight and what he's done with you. He says you're an absolute beast. He's known for his strength, but you're one guy, he says, that meets him and surpasses him in that department. Talk about Sean's training a little bit.
No, he's a big guy. You know, Sean's a non-traditional type of MMA artist, so to speak. I mean, you listen to his interviews, and does not give you the typical interview, but he's a great athlete that got into it late. He's got a great look about him, and he talks smack like nobody's business. I think he's probably talked his way into headlining cards more than anybody I know. Doesn't make him a bad fighter, but he's just young in the game. You know, he doesn't have a base set of skills. And I've talked to you guys, you know, the last couple of days that, you know, you talk about different fighters. They all have a specific base set of skills. And, you know, and the way the sport is now, you know, it's two generations from when I fought. But you got to be good in everything. But there's always a base. There's always something you're really, really good at. And Sean doesn't have that. You know, if you want to give him his best skill, it's a jiu-jitsu. You know, we're on the ground. And that's because he's pretty fearless on the ground. But the other thing about him, excuse me, but he's a big bastard. I mean, he's a big guy. And like all big guys, you have that confidence about you. So when he came in and worked out with me, you know, I mean, he's a little bit bigger than me. I mean, let's face it, he's a little bit bigger than me. I'm a pretty big guy, but he's bigger than me. But, you know, when I grabbed him, it's just like big guys aren't used to being grabbed by another big guy. You know, they get a little shocked and stuff like that. So I don't know if I'm that much stronger than he says I am, but I think he's probably more surprised that I can grab him the way I do and do some of the stuff to him.
Well, he does face Soa Pelele, the big man from Tonga here in Australia. What do you think that Sean's key to victory tonight is going to be?
Honestly, stay away from his left hand. You know, I've watched a couple of his fights, breaking down his fights. I mean, he hits hard. He's, you know, big guys hit hard. You know, and I remember when I first got into the game, you know, I hit hard. I wasn't a great striker. Not that I ever became one, but I hit heavy. You know, I don't think the word hard is good. It's heavy. And when you hit somebody, it's like hitting a pillow, poof, you know, a big, heavy punch. Kind of George Foreman hit really heavy. And Soa hits heavy. Ironically enough, with his left hand. That's what I've seen him drop people with. I did, kind of looked at some film, and he hits heavy with that left hand, which is also his jab hand, but he paused it. I think he baits you into wanting to throw that right hand, so when you're bringing that right hand back, he brings that big left right back over the top to knock you out. So, you know, that's one of the things that's like, look, we want to stand in with him. And, you know, another thing I think we want to do is we want to show him how strong we are. Show them that you're going to be in for a scrap, you know. And I think these are pretty evenly matched guys. I mean, ironically enough, you look at their records; they're one win off each other, one loss off each other. You look at who they fought; they fought really close to about the same competition. You know, I mean, Sean's got a win over Hunt. You know, he's fought, you know, two, three times UFC. Soa's got a loss against Cormier, you know, and he's got some other wins in there. I mean, so they're kind of equal, you know. They've mirrored each other pretty nicely, you know. So it's going to be a fun fight, you know. You never know. One punch changes everything. I've been in enough of them that one punch changes the whole complexion of them. You know, it's like Mike Tyson. Everybody's got a game plan. Do you get punched in the face and it goes out the window? But you know, I'm looking for it. You know, there's a couple of things. I would feel comfortable going to the ground. Was so obviously in the top position. I think we can survive off the bottom. So that's where his, you know, he's best is striking. I haven't seen him submit too much off there, transition anything. But, you know, that's, you know, it's a top position. Mount top position is a great position. You know, I don't care who does it. But, I kind of like what we're doing on our feet. If we can stay disciplined with our hands, keeping our hands up, I like where we can go on our feet.
Well, there's another man in the headlines right now that you've worked extensively with. Of course, that's Matt Mitrione. He has a huge opportunity facing Roy Nelson, where Shane Carwin fell out, to take a step back. It's, of course, been about a year since he's been in the cage, in the octagon. Talk a little bit about Matt Mitrione's keys to success in this fight and what you think his chances are.
Yeah, like I said, you know, I know Matt, and I talk to Matt. I drop him texts all the time, you know, and I'm old school. You know, I don't – look, this is – in life, you don't get a lot of opportunities, you know, and especially in the UFC. I love what Dana's done with the organization, but to a certain extent, it's a little bit cutthroat, you know. So, you know, you miss out on opportunities. You may never get another seat at the table. And, you know, and I called him up right away when he dumped the fight with Cormier, or kind of declined to be in line, you know, when Cormier had those dropouts and strike force. And, you know, Matt kind of gave me his reasons. Like, you know what? Absolutely. I 100% agree with you, you know, and because Cormier is phenomenal. I mean, I think he's kind of looking, you know, I'm biased. He's Oklahoma State guy, so am I. That's not the next big thing, but Cormier is a solid force to be reckoned with in the heavyweight division. But, you know, his fight with Roy, man, I wasn't sure. I got a ton of respect for Roy. You know, I may be one of the few people that do. You know, I don't buy into the character and the eccentrics of Roy, but he's got some skills. He hits hard. He's got some good ground skills, and the guy comes in decent shape. You know, a diabetes candidate like that, like he looks, you know, comes in great shape. So it's really surprising, but you know, I was really on the fence with that fight, and then I start kind of breaking it down. You know, I have a habit of just watching a little film on stuff. So if I'm ever asked a question, like you're asking me a question now, you know, hey, I can answer your question. You know, I'm thinking, wait a minute. Matt's best skills, honestly, are his feet, his athleticism, and on his feet. I mean, he's got decent enough hands, but he's incredibly athletic. You know, I call it cheating a little bit, where he uses his athleticism to fight instead of a good skill set, which he's getting the more he fights. But he very athletic and has got great movement. And then I wasn't completely 100% sold on his chances. Man, I love you to death. I really do. But I wasn't completely sold, for some reason, I'm watching on Spike. I watched the Verdum and Roy fight. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's what you do. I mean, if I were going to take a fight with Roy, you know, so to speak, with Matt's skills, let's keep it on our feet. Let's work some clinch work. Let's work that tie clinch. Oh, my goodness. I mean, that just dominated him. You know, knees, tie clinch, stay outside. Beware of the big right hand. Good movement. Stay in the center of the ring. I like his chances, you know, and I haven't had my quote-unquote had my hands on Matt in a while, but you know, I know he's down there, the Black Zillions. Those guys got, you know, some sharp coaches and stuff like that. They're definitely working clinch work with him. They're working a lot of cage work where they're wrestling and finding space, you know, some time on the cage. I think, you know, people look on cage work and stuff like that where there's some holes there where you can rest a little bit, pick your spots, and do some different things. Where I think that's where you got to fight Roy, when you don't have the black belt skills like Fabricio. You know, I mean, going to the ground. I mean, that was incredible. You know, Fabricio did take him down, more or less had his back early. I mean, within the first 2 minutes of that fight, when they're dry and couldn't sink it. You know, this is an Abu Dhabi world champion that couldn't sink it on Roy, so you got to give him his respect there. So, you know, Matt doesn't have the grappling skill, so to speak, that I would have. You know, I may take him down and then clinch and kind of, you know, Donkey Kong him a little bit, bruise him up. Let's go back to our feet, unless he wants to absolutely give me a finish, which, you know, he wouldn't. But, you know, Matt doesn't do that. So let's stay busy on our feet. Let's stay busy on our feet. If he wants to give you a takedown and go guard, all right, go guard carefully. You know, I mean, I think, you know, depending on who the referee is, you know, if it's Eves, you know, John, who it is, you know, the stand-up situation, you can kind of stalemate the position, take the points off the takedown, win the rounds, kind of sneak through like that. But I like his chances. I really do. You know, I got really excited. I shot him a couple texts. I'm like, look, talk to your coaches. Sit down with your coaches. You want my advice or some input, man, I'd be more than happy. I'm not going to jam it down your throat, but please, the fight's on now. Watch it. This is what you guys should do. Your coaches should watch that and adapt what you do to that fight, you know, and stuff. So, you know, Roy, I'm not calling you out. I mean, I love you to death, but dude, Matt definitely has more skills than you do on his feet with just the athleticism alone.
Nice. Well, Let's go back to 1996 a little bit, and of course that was the first year of your fighting career. And of course you went down. You had three fights the first night of your MMA fighting career, which culminated with your bout, legendary bout with Murilo Bustamante.
You know what? I apologize to interrupt you. That wasn't the first. You know what the first one was? Contenders.
Really?
I fought Toyoshi Kasaka. It was a John Peretti thing. It actually, ironically enough, just resurfaced on Facebook with Peretti. You know, we had Kenny Monday. Got submitted by Matt Hughes.
Oh, wow.
John Lewis, I think, was in that. Myself, Townsend Saunders. We had, you know, a couple Olympic gold medalists, wrestlers. I mean, and that was a big testosterone event because all these wrestlers, us cocky, arrogant wrestlers, went in there. And I actually grappled, and I won't say fought because it was a grappling event, Toyoshi Kasaka, and I beat Kasaka. I was one of the few wrestlers that actually won that night.
A UFC contender himself in his heyday.
And then you know, Cyrus knows this and stuff like that. He's seen it and stuff like that. People look at my ankle. I've got a pretty bad ankle and stuff like that, and I'd already broken it, and he had me in an ankle lock. And John was a ref, and I asked me, you know, stop. I'm like, no, he can break it again. I'm used to it. And he looked at me kind of like, I'm fine. God, please, no, I'm good, I'm good. And I think Toyoshi was a little surprised that I wasn't going to stop, you know, and he had my, I was dead to rights, but, you know, it's just knucklehead wrestler mentality. I'll push through it, and, it, you know, it's broke, I'll limp, and well, I'm still going to finish the fight. But fought him first, and then we rolled into Mars, martial arts reality super fighting.
Yeah.
Three fights that night. That was interesting for sure.
Talk about the fight with Bustamante. Of course, you had a little bit of size on him, but he is a legend. He's truly from the original Carlson Gracie group. The guy, it was world renowned, and you were world renowned as a wrestler. You know, talk about that matchup and going in, what you were thinking.
Well, you know, as a tournament setup, you know, and you don't know how the fights are going to go. In terms of all you're going into the fight. So it's really important that you stayed relaxed after each round. After each round of that fight, I went back to the locker room, took my clothes up, took a shower, relaxed, you know, and just refreshed and stuff like that. I didn't expend a lot of energy. I mean, I think I had, I don't remember when in the order, Willie Peters, and then Alex a Russian gentleman first. And honestly, that one was probably, even though I ended up fighting Murillo for 40 minutes in the final, the fight with Alex was the scariest fight, in a sense, early in, you know, in that thing, because he just wouldn't tap. Pummeled him to no, I mean, that's, you know, people might have seen my Kevin Randleman fight later, and that was a pretty brutal knockout, but that was a couple clean shots. I pummeled this Russian guy unmercifully, and I got scared. You know, because at the time I was like, look, you know, no ties, no this, and, you know, they're going to put the alternate fighter in. And this guy wouldn't tap, and I was getting tired just pummeling this guy. Finally, they stopped it. I mean, coming back, you kind of find out, I think they put 47 stitches in the guy's face to put his face back together. And, I mean, I end up seeing him the next day, and kind of hamburger-esque, you know, but I was scared. I was terrified in that fight that, my gosh, I'm out already, and I'm pummeling this guy. I mean, I'm clearly winning this fight, but the guy wouldn't tap. He just sat there and took it. He had a gi on. It was, I mean, if somebody could find that fight, you want to look at something brutal, you know, that's pretty bad. But going into your Murillo fight, you know, I was a rookie, man. I was young. Wrestler's ego, you know, taken down, I can beat anybody type of thing.
How long did you have between fights in the tournament?
Because there were so many Brazilians on that card, that event was kind of set up a little Brazilian versus the U.S. type of thing, and they had some, you know, some super fights with some other Brazilians and stuff. That it went quick. All the Brazilians were rolling people up. I think Mario Sperry was on it. Travin was on it. Henzo, that might have been the event that Henzo fought. I know I talked to Cy about this. Henzo fought Oleg Tokhtarov, cleaned him up with the upkick. You know, so they rolled some people up. So, ironically enough, they had a lot of time. Back in the day, you were buying TV spots, you know, that 2-3 hour window on pay-per-view. So I think I had probably about 30 minutes, 45 minutes before a couple of the fights. You know, because we went relatively quick, you know, in the old days of the tournament format. But Yeah, that was that. You know, going out there, I was really relaxed. You know, because like I said, I think I had the Russian kid first. Submitted Willie Peters really quickly, a little neck crank, and then, you know, kind of rolling out there. But like I said, I was a baby. You know, and, you know, position and stuff like that. And this was kind of in essence peak of the Cold War in terms of jiu-jitsu was a style that beat anybody. Any size, anybody. I don't know if people, you know, I know I'm an old guy. You might not remember that, but that was the big broad stroke that jiu-jitsu, Brazilian jiu-jitsu came in with, the Gracie jiu-jitsu came in with. You know, it doesn't matter. Size doesn't matter. You know, we can beat anybody, you know, and that's where the big mismatch is. I was probably weighing at that time, you know, 270 or so, 280. Marilla was rolling around about 210, maybe 215 or something like that. It wasn't really, really big. And, but knew he was a phenomenal grappler. You know, I mean, everybody, you know, if you're talking about Sperry, Henzo, Trapp, they're all phenomenal grapplers, all these guys. And maybe Carlos Bejeto was in there, which was probably the weakest of those, that group of grapplers, you know, jiu-jitsu guys. And so I knew the good grappler, but it wasn't until like the first takedown that I felt like I was trying to hold down a snake. Where you just couldn't hold them, you know. I'm in guard, and I trained enough, you know. I worked with a gentleman named Rico Ciparelli, who's just kind of love him to death. Really unique individual, but I love him to death. He's a great teacher, and so I had an idea. But you know, Murillo's guard, you know, I can always feel him kind of shrimping off to a side, you know, sliding out, and there. I think he might even caught me. Obviously, the fight had been over, but arm barred. There's a couple situations. Maybe I think we call it maybe a triangle attempt, and each time, you know, one I probably kind of cheated with my size, just a little awkward for him. But I could just remember and listening to, you know, the coaches cutting off the angles on him, not controlling his hips. You know, coming up underneath his hips a little bit, taking him off. You know, I think one of the things in guard. You know, those guys are so phenomenal when they close their guard, and even open guard, they can slide their hips and stuff like that. One of the things that, luckily, I was able to figure out to pinch him up, come up, pinch up. Well, my hips got pretty good position wrestling-wise, and pinch up his hips. So I stopped his hips from floating on me. Yeah. And we're out there, and the fight was supposed to only go 20 minutes. And I remember, before we got to the ring, somehow or other, Louis Ciparelli, who was kind of doing some work for me, great guy for me, helping me, had said, if you need it, there will be a 10-minute, that will go 10 more minutes, because the Brazilians cleaned up everybody, so they had a lot of TV time. They had extra TV time to kill. So like, well, if you need it, we can go 10 more minutes. So there could be a possibility of a 30-minute fight, because they didn't have any judges. That was probably the biggest mistake that event made. They didn't have judges. They anticipated finishes in all their fights, and they got all finishes in their fight. Ironically enough, anybody checks that record, the only fight that didn't have a finish or went to a judge, which there wasn't any, was our fight. So, you know, I'm like, okay, there's a 30-minute fight, but, you know, for about 15 minutes or so, we did a lot of work on ground. We transitioned in and out of takedowns. We, you know, I'd let him up, you know, he'd get out or something like that, scramble to position, got out, get back into, you know, into guard, and I was really fortunate never to let him get, you know, out of my guard. I mean, I always stayed in guard in half and stuff like that. I was able to never let him kind of to sneak out. I never got so bold as to go to half or try to mount and stuff like that. I kind of beat him up a little bit, be really physical, you know, the old wrestler. It wasn't laying prey. I was relatively active. And then it just dawned on me. I'm like, this fight is not going to be finished. I got to try to knock him out. So I stood. And that's where, you know, you got a lot of the, remember in that fight, Murillo did a little boot scoot. And that fight, you know, I mean, he, you know, he came to know that he's not going to want to stand with me, because he will go right back where he was. So he might as well just stay there, try to catch me in transition coming in. And I came to the conclusion I wasn't going to finish that fight down on the ground. And oh, by the way, the longer it goes, the tighter I get. The odds definitely swing in his favor, you know, size.
Of course, there was a time period where you didn't have to maintain top position like you do today. After the Boss Rutan and Randleman fight, everything changed, of course. But back then, everybody believed you could win from the guard. You could punch the guy from guard, and you're going to, you know, you could take a decision, even though, you know, obviously it went to the draw. Let's move on a little bit. Absolutely. To the Pride era. Talking, well, let's talk – No, man. Let's talk about the Pride era. Of course, you spent the time in the golden age there of Pride. Of course, you were in the first Pride video game. We were talking about that, featured in that. You spent a lot of time with guys like Gary Goodridge, who you faced, and Henzo, who's a guy I actually spent a lot of time with in New York at his gym. He's a very remarkable personality. He's one of the most the greatest people I've ever taken class from, because he's just such a personality and so fun to be around.
Gracie's, but that's my favorite guy.
Yeah,
you know, and I know Henzo the best. You know, and I met him at the Mars event, but probably one of the more outgoing of all the Gracies.
Yeah.
I think for the most part, you know, I really appreciate, you know, fighters. You know, I mean, we have a good bond with them, but Henzo is probably the best and probably the, you know, the most open, emotional, fun to be around. Yeah. Out of all those guys. I mean, you've trained under him and stuff like that. Matt, you know, Sarah and all those. I mean, there's a whole list of guys that definitely give him great praises. So I don't think I'm too far off in thinking that.
Well, you know, we were talking about a couple of the stories. You mentioned Alex Stiebling, of course, the Brazilian killer back in the day. He had that win over Valdez Ismael. Had a little win streak. He was a tough, resilient guy, and but he had some antics. And you had mentioned a little experience you had where him and Wanderlei Silva had an encounter. About that a little bit.
That was Alex Stick. That's how Pride picked him up, more or less. He I don't know if it was an IVC show or something. He went down to Brazil and had he had three fights, beat three guys. He submitted, I don't want to say submit. I you can probably check the facts on that. I'm not sure. But beat three Brazilians one night. Boom. Beat three Brazilians. Then I think he went down there again or something like that. Beat another Brazilian. I mean, so he had a streak of four or five wins against decent Brazilian guys.
Nobody was beating Brazilians at that time.
I mean, that was unheard of, you know. And there's, you know, Alex is, you know, this little corn-fed kid from Indiana going down there and had all the success. And then Pride picked him up, and ironically enough, he fought Waleed, you know. And I happened to know Waleed, met him was it Waleed or Allen? Goas. I can't remember his first one. Was it Allen or Waleed? I can't remember. Yeah, I knew them both. But anyway, you know, Pride picks him up. And he only had one corner person. And this is, I'd already been over to Pride, you know, two or three times, fought a couple times, and then kind of got to be friends with Gary and went over him, you know, helped corner him and train him a little bit. And he brought a young man named Jeremy Bolt, who fights a little bit, but Jeremy's like, you know, he's like a cup of coffee, 130 pounds or something like that. So Jeremy's his guy, and Alex isn't a big guy anyway. He's, you know, like a middleweight or a, you know, lightweight. I mean, at the, think, 50 or something like that. And so we're over there, and the event is, I want to say Osaka, but we flew into Tokyo. And you fly into Narita, which is their major, the international airport, and you transfer over to Haneda. And so the whole fight crew is there. Everybody on the fight card is in the airport. And everybody's got their group, and this is more or less at the peak of Wanderlei's, probably in the early stages of his peak, you know, when he was becoming into his, I mean, that's, Wanderlei, let me tell you something, folks, Wanderlei earned his name the Axe Murderer in those early Prides. I mean, that was a very brutal individual to watch. I mean, there's two guys in Pride back in those days, when I first got into it, two guys you didn't want to mess with, and one of them was Wanderlei, and the other was Igor Vochanchin.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they both wrecked you. And
a lot of people called him the predecessor to Fedor. He's kind of like the first Russian nightmare, and he's the first person to beat Mark Kerr too.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he was definitely a monster. But, you know, so we're in the airport, you know, and Shootbox has, I believe Anderson Silva was in there, maybe even Shogun might have been with. You know, we're all in the airport, and I sit with Gary, and, you know, just like we're in this lobby area, and all of a sudden you hear some yelling and screaming, and over in a corner, and you see Wanderlei up, looking like he wants to kill Alex. I mean, he wants to fight Alex. And Rafael Cordero, that was, and he's like kind of saying something to Wanderlei and kind of looking at Alex. And, you know, Gary and I mean, you know, bigger guys, we kind of get up, go over there, hey, what's going on? And Wanderlei doesn't speak near the English that he does now. I mean, not that he's fluent, but he's like, you know, I kill him. He's screaming at him. And Alex, he's just the nicest kid. He's like, I don't know what's going on. I don't know. We're like, what did you do to him? What did you do to him? You know, why is he so pissed? And he's like, he's staring at me. And Wanderlei, he's staring at me. What to fight me? I'm like, so, and Alex is like, no, man, I have a lot of respect for him. I was just looking at him. I'm like, don't look at him. We're like, don't look at him. You know, and he's still right there. And when Alex is talking to, you know, about, you know, I was just, and he was pointing at Vanderlei. And it's just like, oh, please. And Vanderlei's, you know, he doesn't understand English. He thinks he's being called out some more, embarrassed. So he's getting pissed. And he wants to be, we're like, hey, we're, Gary and I are stepping in between him. Finally, we kind of get it calmed down. It's like, Alex, you got to sit with us from now on. This rest of this trip, you got to stay with us. And the funny part is, Jeremy Bolt's nowhere to be found. I mean, I think he's probably behind a garbage can somewhere, standing up straight, and he's behind a garbage can. You can't see him. But, yeah, that was kind of crazy, you know. I mean, and Alex, you know, didn't do anything except probably had his Brazilian killer shirt on, which, you know, you don't, you know, it's like poking a tiger at the zoo, you know. And, oh, by the way, you're in them, so that's probably not a good idea. And, yeah, Vanderlei was really upset with Alex staring at him, pointing at him and stuff like that. And, you know, and Alex is like, man, I had a lot of respect for him, man. That is so cool. That's Vanderlei Silva, you know, kind of awestruck from what he said. And Vanderlei didn't see it that way. And it was kind of funny, you know. I had some airport people looking around, and the whole shootbox team was there. They weren't postured up to do anything. They're kind of a little surprised. But in the same token, they didn't. Alex was not on a lot of Brazilians, you know, Christmas card list, just from, one, you know, he's beating these guys, and two, you know, wearing a Brazilian kill. He's trying to rub it in their faces. You know, but that was your shtick. And then, ironically enough, he goes in the event, and then he wins that night too in the event. So the next, you know, that win the event. So, you know, he represented, but I could promise you, he wanted no piece of Vanderlei in an airport lobby, no, or by the gates. He, big mistake.
Nice. Well, before we close out, I would like to do two things. First, I would like to go back, and of course, you were in that golden age of MMA, but the golden age of the wrestlers in MMA. You were talking about Mark Holman, Randleman, Mark Kerr, those guys. Real quick, give me a rundown of five guys that you feel as wrestlers that place their mark on this sport the most in that era. We're talking, you know, late 90s all the way into 2005, 2006 era.
First guy, Dan Severn. That's our pioneer. That's our godfather. You know, he probably wasn't phenomenal wrestling skills. I mean, that's world-class skills. I'm really biased when you start wrestling. You guys, we've talked a little bit about it, you know, in our stories and stuff. I'm really partial to wrestlers. Love the guy. I mean, that's my sport, and I'm passionate about it. And, you know, when people say, you know, world-class and different, start mentioning different guys, please don't say he's a world-class wrestler. He's a very good wrestler at the collegiate level and different things, but he's not a world-class. So I really take partial to that. But, you know, Dan Severn used to be world-class, but that's our godfather. Dan Severn was our godfather. You know, if Severn doesn't fight in the UFC, I can't say wrestlers wouldn't have got into it, because they obviously would have eventually. But he's the guy that opened the door for us. You know, we looked up to Dan. He's a great individual. And then, you know, obviously Mark Kerr is the next guy. And Mark Kerr probably had, even to this day, the best mindset, rage, anger to get in the cage. He really did. I mean, he enjoyed fighting. I mean, you know, and you guys have interviewed Sean millions of times, you know, and he doesn't like to fight. He likes to get paid. Coleman loved the fight and enjoyed getting paid for it, but definitely loved the fight. You know,
he loved the headbutts too.
Yeah, that was his thing, you know, and they took that away from him and stuff like that. That kind of stunted his career. I think he probably didn't adjust off as well. I mean, probably if you want to pick on him a little bit, that would be his thing. Look, you never adjusted. They took the headbutts away. What'd you do? You know, you should have, did you improve your hands or, you know, whatever? You know, and going into sequence, I'd say probably Randy Couture. Randy's probably in the middle of the pack talent-wise. Gosh, love Randy. I coached him in college. But he's the smartest wrestler that got into him, in the sense that he put it all together. Nutrition, training camp, massage therapy, jiu-jitsu, boxing coach. He obviously had his grappling, but the grappling to transition to the MMA, one of the smartest guys, you know, that was out there. Another guy that you have to tip your cap to is Dan Henderson. I mean, I Dan Henderson and I both went down to Brazil on the card. He fought the light heavyweight tournament. I fought the heavyweight tournament. I fought Kevin Randleman, and then he fought Eric Smith, who ironically enough were teammates in college. But, you know, we did well down there, and then Henderson won the rings tournament, and, you know, he's got wins over, you know, gosh, it's probably the most decorated fighter, you know, American, so to speak, over quality fighters. What's that, four? Man, I'm sorry, guys. I'm prejudiced. I'm biased. Maybe me. I don't think I'm probably as title credentialed as those other guys. I love, you know, Mark Kerr. I think a few holes, whatever. But me, only in the sense that I did everything. I fought cage rings. I fought K1. Don't ask me why I did that. Well, obviously you paid, but I was there to compete. You know, and I did it and stuff like that. And, oh, by the way, you sprinkled in. I had some good wins over some good folks. Right. You know, and at the time, you know, ironically enough, some of my losses were more or less tributed because I wasn't in shape. But, you know, at the time, when I fought Murillo, going back to that fight, that was a 40-minute fight. That was the longest fight in MMA history at the time until, what was it, Sakuraba and Hoist in the Grand Prix, which went 90 minutes.
And also fought Shannon Briggs, who was a world-renowned boxer at the time, but in a K-1 fight.
I fought Shannon and stuff like that, man. You know, and I tell you what, if I'd have cleared that first round, I would have had him. Yeah, of course, I would have had. I would have had anybody, right? But you know, I was low kicking him. You know, I wasn't going to try to dirty box. I wasn't going to buy it. And that was the thing. You know, people ask me, why didn't you kind of clinch him and throw him around? I'm like, you know, I'm a competitor. I want to beat you. I'm not going to say I want to beat you striking because I couldn't beat him striking. But I knew if I kicked at his legs enough, it sure hurt the hell. I mean, I remember the next day he was limping around. I think I clipped him with four decent kicks, you know, for me. You know, they're not quality, you know, Peter Arch type stuff. But decent kicks where he definitely felt them. And he was limping the next day. But, you know, my headache was gone and he still had a limp. So I actually kind of won that part of the battle. But that was all good. But, yeah, I would say you throw myself in five. But, you know, that was that older generation. You know, you said the prime. I mean, it. You know, right now it is so exciting, you know, because there are so many phenomenal guys coming up, young studs, you know, and I'm really biased towards Oklahoma State. That's where I wrestled. You got Johnny Hendricks. You got Daniel Cormier. You know, like I say, he's out there in the wings. Mo the Wall, King Mo the Wall, he's an Oklahoma State guy. You know, Cain Velasquez, he's got, you know, implanted extra lung. I mean, so when you go to lace him up, you know, with Cain, you better know you're going to five rounds. And he's got plenty to go. And so there's a lot of great wrestlers in here, this next generation of wrestlers. John Fitch, he's coached him at Purdue. So there's a lot of great wrestlers. But, you know, as an old school guy, you kind of have to look and pay respects to the guys, Severin, Coleman, myself, Henderson, that have paved the way that these guys are getting the big bucks and doing well. You know, you got to kind of know a little bit about your history of the game, a little bit and stuff like that. You don't have to respect me, but you know what? I got in the cage, I got in the ring, and I did it. You know, I should get the respect just in the fact that I was able to compete like you. And ironically enough, in the actual Vale Tudo rules, we're talking about no rules. When you go down to Brazil, when I went down to Brazil that time, that was still Vale Tudo. I mean, that was, you know, the Gary Goodrich
bare knuckle.
Gary Goodrich yanking on the nuts. Matter of fact, when I fought in Mars, that was like a glove. I mean, I was Michael Jackson there with little gloves. There wasn't padding in those things. It was more token than anything else. But so yeah, I've gone through a lot of the different time frames. You know, Pride was 2 10-minute rounds. Oh my goodness, who does that? You know, now they're, you know, the 5-minute rounds and stuff like that. But
were you in with Mike Van Arsdale? Were you in contact with Mike Van Arsdale when he went down to the IVC and fought Vanderlei Silva?
No, I knew Mike, you know, wrestling-wise, and we training camps. That's the one thing about wrestlers. We are in training camps together. That's why we were so kind of a close-knit group. It kind of drove some promoters crazy because if somebody was offered something, we'd get on the phone, hey, what's going on? You know, you kind of communicate, helping each other out. And but Van is a phenomenon. He's a freak. You know, I mean,
that was a brutal fight, him and
really athletic, you know, really athletic. And you know, he probably doesn't like to get hit. Who does? He, you know, I think our biggest heel, I guess, in wrestling, you know, the striking part of it, getting hit. That's the one disadvantage I think we have as grapplers. I got to think we're some tough SOBs, but it's the striking part. You know, you look through and you really break down some film and look at, you know, who gave Kerr his first loss. Dude that hits extremely hard. You know, and that, and a really candid.
And a guy that could last because he did endure some time underneath Mark Kerr, and he was able to last it out.
He waited it out. I mean, you know, that, you know, kind of in retrospect, you know, and I tell people this, I'm like, look, I felt like a pretty tough guy going into it, but, you know, and I was honestly a little scared going into some of my fights. Early in my career, I was scared of my fights. So I'm like, I feel pretty realistic, kind of self-evaluating strengths, weaknesses. And the one thing that I didn't know, I knew I couldn't grapple so much with Murillo and evaluate per fight, but the one thing I didn't know, if you could take a punch. I mean, that's a tough thing. I mean, you've got guys like Roy that you can just take baseball bat and hit him with, and you know, and you got a phenomenal grappler and fighter like Andrei Arlovski. You know, I mean, he doesn't take shots very well. I mean, I was terrified, honestly, whether I could. That was the toughest thing I did in fighting. It wasn't getting in there and fighting and rolling around with somebody getting submitted. None of that bothered me. The thing that scared me the most was, could I take a punch? And, you know, early in that tournament, I took a shot, and when I fought Kevin, I took a nice, clean shot, the same little bolo punch, looping, big left that he throws, that he dropped Crow Cop with, he hit me with. Wobbled the knees a little bit, but I kept walking through. Okay, let's go. Screw that. I'm giving you some. I mean, so I was able to take a shot and walk through. I didn't kind of, you know, you can really see how guys take punches, and ironically enough, I'm biased towards wrestlers. I look at wrestlers more. They take a clean shot. They're shrimping down, looking to shoot. They're going to dive in on the legs. A lot of people do it. You know, like, oh, I don't want to get hit like that again. Please don't do that to me again. Where, you know, killed me in K1, taking a shot and then walking in and taking about three or four more. But, you know, going in and, hey, getting hit. And, you know, once I went through that early in my career, I'm like, I'm good. If I'm training, I'm good. I can take a little bit of a punch. You know, I mean, I'm not going to sit there and let someone cave my face in. But taking a punch and being able to go forward is kind of, it's a good feeling in a weird way.
You're 48 years old, right now? Well, I was gonna say, you ever consider jumping in there and doing maybe one more? I know that you had a big layoff about a 4-year layoff there at one point from your heyday, and then you went back in. Of course, fought Fabricio Verdun, looked good. You actually hit the lateral, stayed on top, and ended up.
Well, you took me down off that.
Yeah,
in that fight, I don't know. We were somewhere at the venue or something. Somebody asked me about Fabricio, and I'm like, you know, when I fought Fabricio, he was shooting on me. I'm like, what the hell are you doing? Obviously, of course, you weren't going to stand with me. I hit too hard and too heavy. You didn't want me to take you down because then I could dictate possibly the position. Now, he's still phenomenal, but if I initiate, I could probably maybe pass, you know, depending where I caught him, because you know, even off that lateral, I caught him in the side, which he scrambled back out of. But, you know, and boy, in retrospect, as a coach speak now, of course shoot on him, because now he can dictate how quick he goes to guard. If he gets it clean, he's going to get it clean. If not, he goes to guard. He's going to make me work at a pace early in a fight that capitalized later, which obviously he did. You know, so it's like, okay. I mean, which was it's a great concept, the way, you know.
But you didn't look bad. You didn't look – you looked actually very imposing in the fight and until the very end. But you were in your early 40s at the time. Let's say, what if you – were to maybe step into the cage with Brock this day, how do you think that would go? Well, truthfully speaking,
I actually touched on that in the underground. Look, ego wise, if there's a guy that doesn't say he's going to kick my butt first, a fighter doesn't say he's going to win a tournament, that dude needs to stop fighting because he's not worth his salt. Ton of respect for Brock. He's done some things I haven't, and then I've done others in wrestling that he hasn't. Brock is a very large man, and by the way, if you guys are sitting next to me, a lot of you guys kind of know it, but I'm a pretty big guy myself. Overall wrestling and fighting skills and cage time, I have more experience than Brock, you know, and I believe that could be my ego speaking, but Brock is a north-south type of guy, because I broke him down. We were on the freestyle circuit, the elite level senior circuit, we wait, you know, the college guys come out, they're going to make that step to the Olympic style and come in and try to wrestle. So we kind of all looked at, you know, Brock as a potential opponent. So you're breaking him down, you know, he comes straight at you. Brock is nice. He's quick. He's pretty quick. He's explosive and stuff like that. But I'm a little better, I think, in my opinion. So he's not going to take me down. He's going to have to stand with me. Now, I'm not the striker, you know, like the Demolition Man, you know, Alistair, but I can hit pretty heavy, you know. So I got to think I have it. I don't want to say I know I have an advantage. So do I like that fight? Yes. I mean, people got the proverbial Kerr, Coleman, Erikson, Lesnar. I'm like, well, if you put me and Lesnar together, I'm going to beat him, and then I got to take Coleman over Kerr, and then I'm going to beat Kerr or Coleman because size matters. when you got some equal talent and wrestlers with our strong bases, I think I'm going to win. And I guarantee you put Mark right there, and he's going to call me a dumbass and tell me how he's going to beat my ass, etc. But, I that match, I definitely like that match. And, you know, another matchup, guys, this is my ego speaking, purely ego speaking, but there's only a handful of guys I think can beat Kane. I think you need a guy like my size to go ahead and negate his takedown skills, where Kane is probably going to pound me into submission, is in that third, fourth, and fifth round, where he's got lungs like no other, and he's going to go just as hard, if not harder, the later rounds when guys are tapering off and stuff like that. I'd like my matchup with Kane. You know, maybe even Cormier, too. I'm on it, ironically enough, and I think those guys, this isn't wrestler bias, but those guys are going to do some damage to some folks. You know, a guy that would give me trouble, the damn Brazilians, you know, because get me tired, get me reaching, arm bars, triangles and stuff like that, catching my back because I'm getting tired and stuff like that.
Well, before we close out, one last thing. I'm going to throw out some names, and I want you to tell me in 10 years, your opinion, which name is going to shine above the rest of them, okay? First off, Johnny Hendricks.
Good.
Okay.
Oh, you want me to answer that?
Well, I'm just going to throw them out, and I want you to give me the, you know. Chael Sonnen. John Jones, Daniel Cormier.
John Jones is at the top right now. You know, I mean, he's got to be careful. He's the one you got to be worried about the most because he's at the top. He hasn't really been challenged, so to speak. He hasn't known a lot of defeat. I mean, he's been there. You know, so people are chasing him. He's there. Ton of upside. Cormier and Johnny Hendricks. I mean, those are two hungry, hungry guys. Johnny is a phenomenal guy. They're both Oklahoma State Cowboys wrestlers, my own alma mater. Those guys are coming. They've got a ton of upside. Daniel's hungry, and as long as Daniel stays hungry, he's going to be dangerous. You know, the thing about him that I worry about him that happened to me that I think I had kind of two careers. You know, one, I got it going. I had it figured out. Fights, I start getting dangerous, got the feel of the ring, no fights for a while, started up again, a couple more fights, got it going again, no fights, and then I start taking, you know, what I call the freak show, where I was just taking, I took a fight in 4 days notice, but, you know, you got to keep Daniel engaged, as long as Daniel's engaged, he's making money, and he's engaged, and he's got good fights, got a ton of upside. Chael needs to write a book and help these other guys. You know, as far as where he's going to go in the sport, I think he could probably be more an ambassador and a help to these younger guys. As far as fighting wise, he's got the skill set, but he's had his couple title shots. They're not going to keep going and giving that. We've seen that. We've done it. We've seen it. And for as good as he has to a sport, when you lose, hey, when you're winning, a lot of what he says and does, the amp and the excitement, is exciting, but when you lose a couple in that same fight, it gets old and redundant, and it's not, and you have to tweak it up. It's like, you know, coaches yelling at a guy, yelling at their team. You can only get away with yelling at him before you have to get bigger. Then you throw a chair through a window, and then there's no more windows and chairs to throw, and your team gets like burnt out on it, a la the New York Jets. You know, that been there, done that. It's old. We can't get excited with your rah-rah stuff, but I love Chael. I went to Abu Dhabi with him. You know, and know I'm a wrestler, you know, talked to you, got some stats on him. I went and looked it up, made sure I kind of found out the stats on him, but real great guy. I think he could help, you know, Johnny Hendricks, Daniel Cormier, John Jones. He's got the UFC machine helping him, so he gets it.
You already touched on Kane. We'll throw him in there as well. Yeah. So those five guys, who do you think is the one man that in 10 years everybody's going to look back and they're going to go, that was the one. That was the wrestler that transitioned to MMA and he made his mark.
Well, Bones Jones, I want to say obviously he's got the Bud Light deal. He's got the deals going now. The next guy I would have to say I would like would be Johnny Hendricks because he's at a weight where he doesn't have to go through a wrestler to get it. Kane, we used to mention Kane's got to go through Cormier, Kane, etc. You know, so that they're going to kind of, so one of those two is going to negate each other, and they may end up going a couple times. You know, you want to see a rematch if the fight's exciting. Where Johnny, I think, I'm not going to say going unopposed, but Johnny, if he gets to that point and he's got the one big one, and if that big one stays out there and they don't kind of ruin him in a sense where, and we're talking about GSP, you know, going, mixing up with Anderson and kind of going through one of those guys, they keep him weight class for weight class. Johnny can go through there. And honestly, I like Johnny going up against Anderson Silva in terms of his takedown, got the big punch ability, but he needs probably about five more fights to fight a guy the caliber of Anderson's transition and striking stuff. But Johnny will get it. I mean, he's really raw, and I think Johnny will get it. Daniel's incredibly gifted. Johnny is too, but Johnny will get it. The work ethic and the way he is, I'll take Johnny because John Jones, by default's already been there, and he's kind of there already.
Well, there's talk about John Jones and Daniel Cormier. Cormier dropping on down and facing John Jones, and they're saying that Cormier might be the only guy that really has the big shot of taking him out.
Absolutely. I'm biased. I know Daniel. I actually recruited him when I was coaching at Purdue. Recruited him there as a wrestler and stuff like that. I love my DC MMA. That's his handle on Twitter. You guys hit him up. I don't know John Joe, but that length, man, you can't deal with length. You know, you want to look at those three, you know, you have the three champs in those weights, GSP, Anderson Silva, and John Jones. What do they have in common? They're champs. But skills and attributes, what do they have in common? Their length. Think about it. They're really long. Strike. I mean, you know, Anderson, I mean, GSP, great grappler, transition, great feel. You know, Anderson, a great puncher. Johnny, just so long. I mean, when you fight him, you think you're probably fighting a spider. Ironically enough, that Spider Silva, but yeah. You know, you're fighting all those arms and legs coming at you, the weight class, and you know, you break down GSP a little bit. He's pretty long too. You know, he's a long arm and stuff like that. We're really hard to get through that and the striking and stuff like that. So those are three really long guys that you got to fight through. But I'll have to go with Johnny.
Nice. That's it. There you have it. Now, before I close it out, is there anything else you'd like to say? Any story you want to leave us with? Anything special you've kept there?
You got to pull stories out of me. You know, it's not one of those things. There's stories, obviously, we don't need to sit there and talk about it, you know, that are recorded somewhere. I mean, and I've probably mentioned a few of them here and there, you know.
Are there going to be any stories here in Melbourne?
Every story's got an event. Heck, I'm here with McCorkle. That just alone, that's a story. I mean, he's given us three of them, and we spent 4 hours today. You know, Cy's been with us. He could he's a story in himself. You know, it's kind of entertaining. As an old school guy, sometimes I want to strangle him, but if you do, it's not him. I can't shoehorn him in, be the serious, let's get focused to do his thing. So you kind of have to adapt to him and stuff. But it's a great sport, man. It's a great sport. You know, I mean, it's progressed. I think that's the fun part of it. We've come to a point. I was at the event yesterday, and I'm talking to this regional bigwig from Adidas. They say Adidas, but an Adidas, and that's exciting. You know, they're going to run a sports book either at the event or in conjunction with this. Look, when they're starting to make money like that on that sport, you know, a sport that was basically in the, you know, boatyards down in Florida, a la Kimbo Slice, to the level that we're at now, where we've got major players like Nike, Bones Jones, you know, Adidas coming on board, Budweiser coming on board, you know, the Budweiser one's probably making the boxing folks shake because that was the big dog sponsor in boxing, and which kept us out of a lot of states. But you know, we are going mainstream. They're still upside, and love or hate Dana White, he still sees there's upside in this thing. You know, and he's gonna unfortunately get that money. But I mean, there's a lot of upside to the sport still, and there's still a couple generations left to go where the sport's gonna evolve. We're not there yet. We're not. The sport skill wise hasn't peaked yet. You know, I mean, I look at some of the stuff I do. You know, my ego says I can go with this guy and Brock and stuff like that. But, you know, the sport is, you know, one or two generations past me. I'm no fool. But it's so neat. You know, you're part of something that's growing, you know, and keep going and stuff like that. It's an international sport. It's a worldwide sport. We're here in Australia. We're doing this in Australia. 10 years ago, you know, we can only do it in Alabama and, you know, a couple other small states, you know, in the United States, where we couldn't do this, you know. And you know, we're here internationally. We're making international stars, you know. They're not North America stars, but you know, Brazil and the Americas. We're worldwide, and that's exciting. You know, I mean, if that doesn't get your blood pumping, if you don't like this sport, I'm telling you, this sport is a worldwide sport, and it's exciting. I'm just as passionate about this as I'm in wrestling. You can be the best in the world at what you do. How cool is that? There's people in this building. I mean, you can't, there's no way to regulate that, so to speak. Who do you know? I mean, the World Series in baseball, They play baseball in Japan. That's not a world sport. But in MMA, wrestling, you can, when you're the champion of the world, for that 25 minutes, There's nobody better than you on the planet and what you are in that cage with that guy. Now, tomorrow may be different, but for that 25 minutes, you're the baddest man on the planet. If that doesn't fire your blood up, man, sell insurance. Work in a mortuary. You aren't in the right sport. I mean, it's exciting. You know, I mean, it's a great thing. And I'm telling you guys, please jump on board to this train because it's going places. You know, I mean, and you may not like some of the conductors that we got in charge of it, but you know what? It's the fans that drive this sport. It's not those guys. It's the fans that drive the sport. It's the underground. It's the people. It's your audience that drives this sport. You know, it drives us. I'm busting my hump because I want to entertain your guys, because if I do, you're going to like me. You're going to tell the promotion. They're going to bring me back. I'm going to fight again, and I'm going to get that love. And it's self-perpetuating. And the sport has done nothing but picked up since I've been in it. And knock on wood, I've been thrown an olive branch to kind of stay with it, even training with guys. And all you people think I should fight or do something, get a life. Get it. Thank you. It's a great honor. Ain't gonna happen unless somebody wants to fork over some money a la Hickson type of stuff. It ain't gonna happen. I was never that class, but appreciate it. Thank you, Sean, for talking your smack, Matt, whatever. But no, everybody's safe. Big Cat ain't going anywhere. But you want to work out, we'll go that. But no competitive for the Big Cat. But anyway, I thank you guys for coming down and give me a chance to shoot the bull with you guys.
Well, thank you so much. It has been a true honor for me to be with the MMA legend, wrestling legend, that is the Big Cat Tom Erikson. It's Casey Oxendine with MMA Inside the Cage.
Standing with Matt Skill. Sorry.
Was there more? Everybody wants to say that there was like a work fight.
Was there work fights?
Yeah. I mean,
But is it like that?
I can't sit there.
Was it that to where they said, you know, they gave you suggestions on how to do it, or was it straight up, you're
going to
win, you're
going to
lose?
You know, I'm not, I apologize, this isn't backpedaling. I wasn't in a room to hear you're going to lose, you're going to win, or whatever. I can only use the how it was approached to me to fight a fight.
Yeah.
So when somebody tells me, a true wrestler, even an MMA guy, but with a solid wrestling background, to stand with a world-class boxer, and Skelton ended up winning the European heavyweight title 2 years or a year after that, or something like that, that they want you to stand with a world-class boxer and trade with a world-class boxer. I mean, technically they didn't tell me to take a dive, but oh my gosh, if that isn't as close to work as, I mean, I guess that gives plausible denial to everybody. We didn't tell them to take a dive. We didn't tell them to take a work. Now, obviously, the biggest one, I think that's on record, and I don't think he's ever answered the question with a straight face, is Coleman and Takata. And you know what? And the defense, if that was a work, and like I say, I've seen Mark ask that question, and I don't think he's ever answered it with a straight face or without smiling or something in a corner to, you know, look at you. In his defense, oh, by the way, he came in and won the Grand Prix and cleaned the table and restarted his career. So, you know, sometimes works, possibility of works or whatever, can do some really good things for your career.
We talked about Fedor earlier, and you said, you know, how skilled he was and just applauded him. You think everybody, it's either he's the best in the world, the best of all time, or he's completely overrated? What is it?
He was really good. I mean, I'm not trying to crack on you guys. I want to say media hype and stuff like that. As a society, you know, as a society in general, we want the baby without the labor pains. We want to put tags on people, ultimate tags, and when they disappoint us, we're so mad they disappoint us, he's the worst. Damn, that dude got in the ring with some really good people. He's fought Nogueira, Krokop, Barnett. He's beat some good people. I mean, some damn good people. You've got to give that respect. Best of all time, that tag is subjective. I only know a handful of guys, and if I'm in the wrong place, if I'm in Boston, I can't get away with saying Michael Jordan's the best of all time. You know, I mean, type of thing. It depends, but you know what? He's in that. If you want to say Fedor the best of all time, he's one of the best heavyweights of all time. That's pretty undisputable. Best of all time, he's in that conversation.
Yeah.
You got to throw, that's a compliment. For right there as a fighter, and someone says, you know, whatever you want to say about me, Look, I don't know, but the fact that you're talking about that, me or something in a specific parameter, thank you, that's an honor. I can appreciate that, but Fedor, he's in that conversation. And if I'm going to sit there and argue with you, I'll give you both sides of it. I'll give you some great points for, some great points against. Because if Fedor stops and doesn't take Antonio Silva, Fabricio Werdum fights, and just never gets an opportunity and just goes away, he would be 10 times the legend that he was for those fights. But because he took those fights, lost those fights, oh, forgot Henderson, you take, you know, his last five fights away where he didn't look great, and oh my gosh, we're not having this conversation because rubber stamp, yes. But yeah, he's one of those guys.
Do you think that his move to America made it, because you saw guys like Wanderlei Silva, you know, saw Minotauro, all those guys.
I'll cut to the chase on that. His move with M1 to make money killed him. His move to make the big bucks killed him. Because that's when, you know, politics got involved. And whenever you put politics, Jesus, look what we're doing in America. The political stuff there in America. When you start playing politics, and you guys know this better than I do, in terms of the inside, we want this, we want that, we want to put him in this organization. They were putting the screws to Dana. Dana's got to rip him, and they're going to, you know, that's when it got ugly and convoluted. You know, I'm going to go to Affliction. When you start shopping out your skills and worrying about the financial aspect instead of just the true fighting spirit, which was what made, in my opinion, Fedor that guy. That he went out, don't matter, I'm just going to keep fighting. I'm going to make money. I'm going to keep fighting who you throw in front of me. Then it got to, I want to make the most money I can in the best venue I can. And you start doing stuff like that, I think that's when it gets really shady. That's when you bring a lot of objectivity into it as a fan. It's like, yeah, but if he came to America, look, that's when it's, I don't want to say he's greedy, but that's when things got a little goofy. When you start throwing money into something, look, you name it. I mean, think about things you've done in your life. When you start throwing money into it, it gets a little hectic.
You mentioned that deal with Pride and how, you know, you were suggested to do certain things. Do you think that Fedor was, after a few of his fights, he was built at all, or do you think that was all Fedor?
No, it was all Fedor. I mean, he's got some skills. I mean, it gets really hard when you're at that caliber an athlete, and Fedor, he's probably in the backside of his career when those some of the obviously the losses and stuff. When you're that kind of caliber athlete, boy, that's a tough pill to swallow. I mean, this is a world class guy, Sambo, you know, that guy, that fighter. I mean, I give him a lot of respect for his fighting ability. I just think, you know, you get the wrong people in your ear whispering in your ear, and the carrot dangled in front of you, and now you start thinking of this, and then that extra training session that you normally would have got when you were really hungry to fight and stuff that you miss takes the edge off. You know, it only takes one or two, and after the first one or two, the third, fourth, fifth session you miss gets easier. I know personally for myself, I retired in 2000. Probably should have done it in 99, but you know, I had family and stuff like that. That extra session, that extra steps that I was going to run or whatever, I didn't. That's the difference. That's that, you know, 1 or 2%. When you get up that top 5%, there's only, it's really, some days it's whatever I ate compared to whatever you ate, who wins? And it gets that fine. And when you start doing some of those things and you drop off, and oh, by the way, you dropped off, but there's potential to make even more money than when you were doing all those things and winning. Man, I don't have to get up and run today, but I could fight this guy and make more money based on what I used to do. Man, I kind of like that, and I could still kind of win. You know, and
what
then
Mike Tyson. What do you think about what Bob Sapp's doing? Where he's, I mean, he doesn't want to take the shots to the head, and, you know, he's friends with Gary, who you're very close friends with, and we've seen what happened with Gary, and it's tragic. However, Bob is kind of taking that and ran with it to the effect that if he gets hit in the head a couple times, he's done, he taps, and he doesn't, I mean, you could say he throws the fight, he doesn't throw the fight, but he takes this money and runs, even though he's a great guy. We've talked about this. He's a great,
I like Bob.
Awesome, nice guy.
I like Bob, and I'm
how
gonna,
do you feel, what's the fighter and you feel about it?
I'll back up a little bit, and it'll make sense kind of with the story, I'm full of them. Kurt Angle jumped ship right away, wrestler. We know Kurt Angle, right? Kurt Angle. Yeah, you should, right? Kurt Angle jumped ship after the 96 Olympics. We were extremely prideful wrestler, the wrestling community, the elite level wrestling community, extremely prideful of WWE, WWF at the time, WCW, that was BS. That denigrated what we were doing. And my thoughts, my honest thoughts, and Kurt and I weren't real close, but we were good friends. We still are, but he's got to take care of a family. Look, there's money to be made. I got to respect a guy that's making money as long as he's doing it in the sense that where he's not going to denigrate his credentials to get there. He parried him a little bit. You know, his shtick going in was the gold medal, the singlets, and the medals and stuff like that. Yeah. But, you know, that guy's got to make money. I don't begrudge a guy for making money. You know, and Kurt did that. And ironically enough, I mean, he's taking more damage to his body doing that than, you know, he's what, two major neck surgery? I don't even know what he's done, but I know rough stuff from the little good I do know, you know, that he kind of lets people know about. But, you know, I got to respect him making money within the profession, expanded, you know, professional wrestling, performance, whatever you want to call it, from a true wrestler. You know, so that's a perfect example. Now you bring it up to Bob. You got to know Bob pretty well. You know, I mean, kind of there in the beginning of Bob's, in a little bit back half of prime of Pride, the Golden Age of Pride, Bob jumped in. I mean, I was with Bob, in a sense, around him with Maurice Smith and that group, you know, when, you know, we'd go to a restaurant, we'd have to call the police to get us out of there. There was 5,000 fans in the glass. We would come in here, that whole area would be fans where we had to get police escort out, eating a dinner with something with Bob. And guy's massive. He's freakishly so. And, you know, I think a little bit now, to the point that he's gotten, it's a little tough, but as a father, a family person, and an older person where there's bills to be paid, you know, insurance, bills to be paid, there's part of me that understands what he's doing. The true competitor of me doesn't like it because you're not training to the level you need to do to go and prepare to do that. You know, if he's doing all the right things, the gym, putting the time in, and then kind of that's his attitude going in there, I don't want to take the damage, he feels he's outmatched, he's going to step out of it. I can live with that. A little tougher to swallow, live with that, but to not train and go in and take a paycheck and stuff like that, to a certain degree offends me. To be candid with you, not to the sense where I'm gonna begrudge him and be angry, but yeah. A little bit, you know. But I gotta respect he's gotta feed family and stuff like that, but I would give a percentage. Terms of blame, anger, whatever you want to call it, promotion, fans, for accepting it. You know, you guys are smarter. I'm looking at, you know, you, fans, promotion, you're smarter than that. You should expect more. And when you bring Bob in, and I can respect it, he's a great draw. I mean, geez, how many times you get to see a gentleman that's 6'7", 300 something pounds of, you know, 5% body fat. You know, I mean, he's a little softer now, but this incredible beast of a man, not to make a pun of his name, but compete. I mean, oh my God, this is a pretty big guy. And do his whole thing. You know, that's kind of entertaining, but he's still doing that on the real circuit. So I think we all have to take a piece of the pie
would
and say, look,
if you were in his position, you know, same size, blah, blah, and you started getting offered $30,000, $40,000 to go to Slovenia or wherever, you know, some place, you know, Australia. I mean, he came down here and did the CFC show. Would you do it? Would you do what he's doing?
Would I
right
do
now?
It? Yeah. You know what?
Would you tap out? Tap out after about four shots to the head?
I'd like to, the competitor me and say I'd like to make you earn knocking me out. You know, I part of me says I've taken some fight. My fight with Fabricio, I was not trained properly to fight that fight. That doesn't mean Fabricio wasn't going to beat me anyway. But 3 weeks wasn't 6 to 8 weeks that should have gone into a fight like that. But to take it to the point where I'm really not training at all, taking a fight, knowing how tough it is, real life bills to be paid, I would probably take a fight, but my ego and the competitive spirit is not going to let me to keep doing that. It's just, I retired in 2000, and I didn't do the shoes on the mat like they do in wrestling and stuff like that. I wrestled, and I've always told myself, and I'm like, when it's time to quit, I'm going to quit, because I have too much, I know what it took to get to that point. I have too much pride in the sport that I compete in, that I'm not going to keep doing that. And that was at the time. I quit in 2000. Lost the matches to people in the States I maybe shouldn't have, because I wasn't running those extra steps, staying in extra practice. But at that time, I was still one of the five, conservatively one of the 10 best wrestlers in the world at my weight. I mean, I was one of the best guys in the world at my weight. Even the little extra things I probably should have done that I was doing, and that's when it scared me. If I'm still this, and I'm doing this, and I don't want to be content. That's not why I did this. I want to do this because I want to be the best. And to be the best, you got to do all those extra things. And so I needed to quit. Yeah. But that the finances are a little different. Wrestling's pride. I mean, that's just ego. You might have got a little bit of money, but the fighting stuff, solid answer. You want to say, okay, I need a real yes or no kind of solid answer. I would have done it probably, given it a shot, and then I would have disgusted myself and said no.
Yeah.
It doesn't make me a better person than him. I don't know his family, financial situation.
His argument was that he was doing it for bargain prices for them, and it made it hard for possibly, if he were to get hurt, he had these other offers on the table. So if he was doing it, this fight, for a bargain price, then next month when his next fight came up, he would be unable to do that because of the injury that he's taking.
No, I got you. Look, he only has to, there's only one other guy that can answer that question, and that's the guy that's in the mirror. That when he looks in the mirror, that's the only guy that can answer that question. And like I said, I don't know his financial situation, what his food bill is. I don't know those things. Bob's an entertainer, you know, and he's comfortable with that, and he's got that's a way he's sustaining and making his money. Man, I can appreciate it, and okay. But for me to get on a soapbox and gripe against that, really tough for me to do. Would I do it differently? Yes.